All right, good morning, church. Hey, are you guys already fired up about the service right now or what? Now, this is incredible. All the baptisms, first service, second service, have been incredible. Welcome to those who are worshiping online. So glad you're here with us. My name's Tyler, serve as the lead pastor here. And I just have to say, I didn't say this in the first service because it just didn't happen, but sometimes there's a point in a service that just kind of captures me. Like captures my heart, brings tears to my eyes. And for me, this last one, it was in the midst of the baptisms over here. And it was when Carly and Lexi were up and their dad was filming. I'm looking at you. And I look over there and everybody's filming. And I could just see the tears streaming down his eyes, streaming down his face, watching his daughters get baptized. And he was so fired up. Remember this? He's like, I can't just take this thing sitting down. So he stood up with his camera and got right in there. He's just like, I just got to be a part of this. And as soon as Lexi got out, he just walked over and gave her a big hug and a kiss. And I just thought, that's what happens. I mean, stuff like that. When God is moving, when the Spirit moves, like we sang, he pulls us in, doesn't he? It makes our heart pound. And we just know that he's filling us up in that moment. So that's what God's happening right in our midst. We're in a series. We've got 2 weeks left of our summer series. It's called Songs of Summer. So we've been in this all summer. We're going through the Psalms of Ascent. And psalm means song. So we're looking at the psalms or the songs of ascent. This is Psalm 120 to 134. It's 15 psalms. This is the middle of your Old Testament. And these are travel songs that the Israelites would see when they were making their pilgrimage three times a year to go up to Jerusalem to worship God for their feasts and their festivals. They would sing these songs as they went, these 15 songs over and over again. It was like their playlist. And this morning's psalm is Psalm 133. And what's cool about this one, it's a Psalm of David. It's the fourth of four Psalms of David. He wrote four of the 15. His son Solomon wrote one. The other 10, we don't know who wrote them. But this is the last one that David wrote. Let's look at Psalm 133 together now. It says, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity." That's us, when we live together in unity. "It is like precious oil poured down on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard." Aaron was the high priest at the time. "Down on the collar of his robe." Next verse, "It," when God's people dwell in community. "It is as if the dew of Hermon," that's Mount Hermon, "were falling down on Mount Zion," that's where Jerusalem was. "For there, in the midst of unity, there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore." So that's the word of the Lord for today. Let's pray together and ask God to add his blessing to the reading of his word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for those of us in this room, those of us watching online. We thank you for the chance to worship you together. We thank you that as we sang and prayed for your Holy Spirit to come down and move among us, we believe and we know that's what you're doing. We've seen it in song, we've seen it in baptisms, now we're seeing it and we pray to experience it in the teaching and the preaching and the application of your word. Lord, my prayer, especially right now, is when your Holy Spirit moves in these next few minutes, and you will, and you start to convict and challenge and press in and poke our hearts a little bit, I pray that we would not resist it. I pray that we would welcome your Holy Spirit to conform us into the likeness and the image of your son, Jesus. And you do that through the teaching and the application of your word. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Let's just cut straight to the point. This psalm, Psalm 133, is about one thing, and here it is: unity. That's the subject of the psalm, That's the point. Let's talk about unity. And all the scriptures exhort, they remind, they encourage, they urge us toward unity. And it is something we have to fight for. We have to, it takes effort. It doesn't happen automatically. And we learn it, believe it or not, from a subtle word in the first verse of Psalm 133. And it's the word "when," if you look at it. This little word right here. "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity, as if to say it doesn't always happen or it doesn't happen easily. It doesn't say how good and pleasant it is that God's people live together in unity, as if it's a given, or because God's people live together in unity. No, it says when. When it happens, it's awesome. It's good. It's pleasant. Now, the Apostle Paul also talks about it in the New Testament. So we've heard of David. He wrote a bunch of things in the Old Testament. The Apostle Paul wrote about two-thirds of your New Testament. And I'm just going to show you one passage in Ephesians 4, one of his letters, where Paul talks about the importance of unity. It's in Ephesians 4 at verse 2. He says, "Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace." So that's the Apostle Paul. So these are two prominent, one Old Testament, one New Testament person in your Bible. The most prominent person in your Bible is obviously who? Jesus, that's right. You don't even know, if you get a question in church, yell out Jesus. You'll be right half the time. Jesus is the most prominent person. Now, Jesus, we got lots of his words. We got his prayers in Scripture. The last recorded prayer of Jesus. So this would be important, right? You're wondering what's on his mind, what's on his heart. The last time Jesus prays in the Scriptures, you know what it is? Unity. He prays for our unity. John chapter 17 at verse 11, look at it. He says, "Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name so that they may be one," that's unity, "as we are one." It's a powerful prayer from Jesus. "Father, just as we are one, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the triune Godhead, three yet one." It's the Trinity. A little mystery involved there. "Just as we are one, may they be one." That's what Jesus is praying. He's praying for our unity. Now, my question is this. Is the church known for unity? You're laughing because you know that for the most part, a lot of times it's not. I mean, that's our charge. That's what Jesus prayed for, but the church is often not known for unity. It's known for people having their own opinions and preferences and disunity and fighting and factions. It's known for people saying, "We want to worship this way. We want to sing those songs. We want to wear masks. We don't want to wear a mask. We want to stay open the whole time during COVID. We should have stayed closed longer after COVID. We want two houseboat trips instead of one so we don't have to say no to any high school students. We want longer sermons that go verse by verse." No, we want shorter sermons that are more topical. "We don't like that you stopped that ministry, so we're going to leave. We're going to start a new church down the road that caters to my opinions and my preferences." Now, here's my question. Now, am I stepping on any of your toes yet? There's a pastor, really prominent pastor. He wrote the best-selling nonfiction book ever written called The Purpose-Driven Life. Just retired as the senior pastor of maybe the largest church in the country, Saddleback Church, down in Southern California. His name's Rick Warren. And he wrote this about unity. This is to each of us. "It is your job to protect the unity of your church." Unity in the church is so important that the New Testament gives more attention to it than to either heaven or hell. God deeply desires that we experience oneness and harmony. By the way, that's a good definition of unity. Oneness in spirit, harmony with each other. Unity is the soul of fellowship. Destroy it. Destroy unity, and you rip the heart out of Christ's body. Ooh, what a quote. I'll give you one more scripture before we dig in a little bit. In the Old Testament, in the wisdom literature, in Proverbs, there in Proverbs chapter 6, there's a little section that says, "Let me tell you six things that the Lord hates." And then he changes his mind and goes, "No, seven that the Lord detests." And he makes a list. And number seven on that list is this right here. It's at verse 19. "A person who stirs up conflict in a family." God doesn't like that. It's right on the list of things the Lord hates and detests, along with murder and telling lies. So it's a big deal to God. Unity. It's obviously important in the church, but it's not just the church. I mean, unity is important in a marriage. Amen? Any married people here? Say amen if unity is important in your marriage. Amen. It's important among our kids and our families. It's important in a dating relationship. It's important on a sports team. Many of us have played, currently play, will play on sports teams. Unity is incredibly important. When you have it, you have success. You have strength. When you don't have it, you have weakness. You do not have success. You know it in a company. Many of you lead teams or are on teams in a company. You know it if you're leading a unit. So let me just get to a big idea. It's a simple big idea that'll be woven throughout this message, and here it is right here. We must be willing to work for unity. Got to work for it in the church. You got to work for it in our families. Got to work for it on our teams. Now, to be fair, I have to be honest with you about this. Because this is true, we, the church, have a spiritual adversary, a spiritual enemy. What is his name? Yeah, Satan, the devil. And he is attacking us on this. He's attacking you and God, trying to divide, put distance and division and doubt in your mind. He's attacking your marriage, my marriage, husbands and wives. The minute we say, I do, he's trying to get us to say, I don't. The minute we say, no, I want to serve her, I want to serve him, he's trying to get us to think, no, I want to be served. He's attacking our families, our teams. He wants factions and gossip and quarrels and complaints about playing time. He wants us to think of ourselves first, not God, not others. He wants us to live in echo chambers. And what I mean, we'll come back to that a little bit later. That means he wants to surround us around, he wants us, our enemy, to surround us with people that think and reinforce exactly what we think. And let me just get specific and press in the church family. This is what our enemy is trying to do to us. He's trying to pit Democrats versus Republicans. He's trying to pit whites versus people of color. He's trying to fit maskers versus non-maskers. He's trying to pit vaccinated people against non-vaccinated people. He's trying to get people that raise their hands during worship like I do sometimes. And you're thinking, down in front. Drop those hands a little bit and chill out, can we? We have an enemy who's trying to subvert our unity. But here's what's great. And I've thought about this in this last week because I knew where God was taking with us in this message. I knew what Psalm 133 was about. And as I prayed for you as a church, God was encouraging me with a few things that I know to be true about you. And the first thing is, you love Jesus. I just know that about you. I love that about our church. You love Jesus. And because of that, you want unity. And here's another thing I know about you. You love the church. You love this church. You love the church. And because of that, you want unity. And another thing I know about you is that you don't just love Jesus. You don't love the church. You love each other. So you want to have unity. And so we come back to this thing. You got to be willing to work for unity. The rest of our time, we got 22 minutes left here. The rest of our time, we're going to look at this. If this is true, we have to be willing to work for it. I want to start with the why. This is why we should work at. We're just going to go verse by verse through Psalm 133, and we're going to see three blessings of community. It's going to encourage us. This is why you should work for unity. This is why it's worth it. And then for our last few minutes, we're going to look at how. This is how we build community. We go through what I call like building blocks of unity, and that's from a different passage. So let's start with the blessings of unity. We're gonna look at blessings of unity. And the first one, if you're a note taker, if you take notes on your phone, if you take notes on a sheet of paper in your Bible, in the margins, whatever, this is a good time to just jot down a few notes. Here's the first blessing of unity that we see from this passage. It's enjoyable to you. Unity is enjoyable to you. We learn this from the very first verse, Psalm 133 at verse 1. I'll show it to you. Here's what it says. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It's good and it's pleasant. The Hebrew word for good means excellent and agreeable. For pleasant, it means beautiful and sweet. We know this. When our family is unified, it feels good. When it's divided, it does not feel good. It is not pleasant. When our team at work is unified, it's great. It's pleasant. It's enjoyable. In the church, same thing. On a sports team, same thing. Now, interestingly enough, the Bible is filled with a lot of examples of things that are good or pleasant, but not good and pleasant. This is saying, no, unity is good and pleasant. You say, what's an example of something that's good but not pleasant? I would say Hebrews chapter 12 at verse 11, discipline. It says, no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but in the end, it produces a harvest of righteousness for those who have been trained by it. So it's not pleasant, discipline, but it's good. What about something that's pleasant but isn't good? That would be something like honey in Proverbs 25 at verse 16. It says, you know, a little bit of honey is nice, but too much is not good. You'll get sick. It's pleasant, but it's not good. Here in verse 1, it's saying, no, unity is good and it's pleasant. It's enjoyable to you. I was talking to a couple recently, and perhaps you know a couple like this, or maybe you've talked to a couple like this. Maybe you are, praise God, if you are a couple like this. I love to ask couples this question. I say, you know what? How are you guys doing? How are you guys doing? And they go, you know what? You know what, Pastor? We, and then they look at each other, we, and they agree, and they start to talk, and they look at each other again. We are in, this is what they said, we're in a really sweet season. We're agreeing, we're unified, our kids, we have unity amongst our kids, our family is just in a really sweet spot. And I looked at them and I go, I wonder what that's like. No, I'm just kidding. I thought, that's awesome. Like, praise God. Like, and you know, you've been in situations like, you may not be there right now as a couple or as a family, but you've experienced seasons like that and it is sweet. It is enjoyable. It is good and it's pleasant. This is the first blessing of unity. We see it. Here's the second one. It's anointed by God. Second blessing of unity. It is anointed by God. Where do we see that? We see that in the very next verse. Let's go to verse 2. Just moving through the psalm. It is like precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe. Now, everything about this verse is trying to say that unity is lit, it's blessed, it is anointed by God. This is one of those cool verses where literally every word builds on itself in terms of meaning. But let's just look at a few things right here. Look at running down, coming down. So the picture here is it's from above and it's coming down. It's from God and it's coming to earth. It's from our Lord and it's coming to us. This is where unity is. It's coming down. It's not of this world. It's anointed by God. Now let's look at the verses themselves or the words themselves. It's not just oil, it's precious oil. So oil was used for anointing. Oil was used as a refreshment. Oil was used for smell. It's precious oil. That's anointing oil made from fresh olives, poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard. So it's overflowing blessings. It's a mighty anointing from God to us where unity is there. Not just running down on the beard, but on Aaron's beard. So it's the high priest that represents God to the people. And so it's a mighty blessing. And not just on his beard, but down on the robe. What is the robe significant? Well, on the robe of the high priest would be all names of the 12 tribes of Israel. So God is trying to say, David is trying to say, the anointing, the blessing of God is so present in unity that it comes from God all the way down to all of the people. All of the tribes of Israel. I mean, this is incredible imagery right here. Unity is a blessing. It's refreshing. There's power in it. There's synergy in it. Let me tell you something about the Holy Spirit. He's allergic to disunity. He's allergic to discord. He blesses unity. You see other examples in Scripture. In the book of Nehemiah, people come together and they want to rebuild the wall around Jerusalem. People go, you can't do that. It won't work. They've been trying it for years and years and years. But the Scriptures say there was unity. It says they worked as one man. They were able to rebuild that whole wall in 50 some odd days. So another place in the New Testament, Acts chapter 2, it says all the people were together. They were unified. And the Lord was adding to their number. Dave was like, services where we've had baptism in the first service and the second service, just like that, just going every single day, more and more people, thousands of people being added because of the unity that was in that place. So first, it's enjoyable to you. Second, there's an anointing from God. And the third thing we see from the very next verse is it's a taste of heaven. This is the third blessing of unity. It's just like a taste of heaven. Let's look at this next verse. It is as if unity, where there's unity among God's people, where there's unity in a family, on a team, It's as if the dew of Hermon were falling down on Mount Zion. For there, at the place of unity, there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore, even eternal life. It's as if David's saying, there's a taste of heaven, there's a slice of heaven, every place there's unity. So let's break this down. It's as if the dew of Hermon, that's Mount Hermon. That's Mountain Dew. Isn't that great? Mountain Dew. In the Bible, can you believe it? Some of you are going like, I'm thirsty. We got a picture of ice cold Mountain Dew, don't we? Yeah, there it is. Doesn't this look good right there? Ooh. Okay, it's back to the verse. The dew of Hermon, Mount Hermon, were falling down on Mount Zion. Let's just pause right there. Mount Hermon was in northern Israel along the border of Syria and Lebanon, 9,000 plus feet above sea level. And it was known for its mountainous region, its cool nights, its dew, snow in the winter, but a lush place. Even though most of Israel's desert, high desert, boy, the area around Mount Hermon, it is lush, it is tropical. If you've been to Israel, you go, man, this is incredible. It's where the mouth of the Jordan River is, right off of the water from the Mount Hermon. And you wake up in the mornings and it's cool and there's dew everywhere. It's like that mountain dew were falling from Mount Hermon, northern Israel, 9,000 plus square feet, on Mount Zion. Where is Mount Zion? Southern Israel, about 2,400 feet above sea level. So it's another picture of this blessing from above coming down from north to south. Everything in between, from high to low, there's something special. It's a taste of heaven, this blessing. It's eternal life. It's life forevermore. I was thinking about like a tangible experience where you think, man, this is like a taste of heaven. And I just kept coming back to this idea of music. There's something about special music when you hear it, man, like that's like a taste of heaven. It might be a worship song. It might be a song that evokes a certain memory in your life. You might be at a concert. You've been at a great concert where you just hear the music and the people are singing. There's joy. It's like a little taste of heaven. I was thinking about one of my favorite bands, U2. U2 has been together a long time. And a lot of bands break up. They've stayed together. And they wrote an autobiography recently. And there was a quote. It was about unity from their drummer, a guy named Larry Mullen Jr., that I wanted to share with you. That speaks a little bit to this, man, it's like a little taste of heaven. And here's what he says. He says, we are four very, very different people with diverse personalities. All of us have various needs, both professionally and privately. We are one, but we're definitely not the same. If there's something special about you two, it has nothing to do with us as individuals. It's what happens when we get together on stage or in the studio. It's very hard to describe and even harder to explain. However, it's the only reason we are still doing this. Listen to this last line, it's really cool. When we play music together, something happens. It's like there's something special that happens. It's like it's a taste of heaven when we play music together. So it's enjoyable, it's anointed, it's a taste of heaven. That's the why. Those are the blessings of unity. Now we're gonna look at the how. Here's what I'm calling those. The building blocks of unity. The building blocks of unity. How do we build unity in our church, in our families, on our teams? If it takes work and we must be willing to work for unity, you're going, am I? You gotta ask yourself that question. Am I willing to work for it? Am I willing to work for it? Are we willing to work for it? Because if we are, there's some things that we got to do. They don't happen on its own. It doesn't happen through indifference. We can't be like this quote from Jay Leno. It's a famous quote from Jay Leno. Perhaps you've heard it before. He says, I'd do anything to have the perfect body, anything except diet and exercise. We can't be like that when it comes to unity. We got to be willing to do what is required to pay the price to build unity. So we're going to go to a passage, and we've already read it this morning, from the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 4. We're just gonna teach right through these two verses. And we're gonna pull out three building blocks, three essentials of unity. So here's the passage. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. So let's start with where the Apostle Paul started and go, what is the first essential ingredient? What's the first building block to unity? And it's this word right here. It's humble. We have to have humility. To have unity, we must have humility. Now, last week's message was all about humility. Psalm 131, a path to humility that leads to contentment, and the picture of contentment we put up on the screen, remember, was a picture of a weaned child. It was a Picasso painting called Mother and Child, a weaned child on its mother's lap, totally content, and the humility that leads to that. Now, in that psalm, Psalm 131, David said the path to humility consists of three things. It's not having a prideful heart, so not thinking I, me, mine, and self, but thinking of God and others. It's not having haughty or prideful eyes, so I'm not competing and comparing with other people. And the third element, third step on that path, if you recall, if not, you can go back to YouTube, you can watch it. The third element was I stay in my lane kind of. It's like I don't concern myself with things too big, too great, too lofty for me. And the literal translation of that is about feet and about walking. It basically says, I stay in my lane. There's humility to staying in your lane. And so last week was all about humility. What I want to point out right now, and this is an important point to kind of get out there, and that is unity does not mean uniformity. It doesn't mean we all need to be the same. Matter of fact, the scriptures speak against that. They say, you're the body of Christ. Each one of you has different gifts. Each one of you has a different part to play. So unity is not uniformity. It's not sameness. It doesn't mean we can't have our own opinions or our own points of view. What it does mean, and this is where humility comes in, is that we need to value others almost literally above yourself, above ourselves. I see the value in other people. I see the value in others' views, opinions. This works in a marriage. This works on a team. This works in any group. And it certainly works in the church. I can't help but think of Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. It's another place where Paul talks about humility. Listen, he says, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, any tenderness in compassion, any comfort from his love, any common sharing or unity in the spirit. He says, then make my joy complete by having the same love being one in spirit and purpose. That's a picture of unity. And then he says this, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in, here's the word, in humility, consider others above yourselves. That's the picture. That's the path to unity. Now, why is that so hard? Like, honestly, why is humility so hard, yet so necessary for unity? I'm gonna point it out two ways. Number one, and we just talked about, we have some inside out things that push against our efforts to be humble. And that is our pride, our haughty eyes, our desire to like not be in our lane, but to concern ourselves with other people's lane. Like, there's inside out things that push against our humility. But there are also, I just want to point out a couple. There are also some outside in influences that push back against our efforts to build humility. Let me just give you a couple ones. The first one, it's a phrase I learned from a book of this title. And the phrase is, the death of expertise. The Death of Expertise. That's a book. It came out about 5 years ago by a guy named Tom Nichols. Let me show you a few quotes from this book that speak to the outside-in influences that push back against our efforts to be humble. So here's a few quotes. Never have so many people had so much access to so much knowledge and yet have been so resistant to learning anything. Another quote. Not only is the internet making us dumber, it's making us meaner. Someone say amen. Here's another quote. Human beings learn by putting aside their pride and ego, that's humble, humility, long enough to accept instruction. Let me give you one more quote. At the heart of this death of expertise is, yeah, I know what you said, but I Googled it. So it's like, I know what you said, but I Googled it. Let me show you a story real quick that that kind of plays this out. And that is, a few weeks ago, I mentioned that I took my oldest son, Trevor, on a trip to the Midwest for a football camp at Northwestern that he wasn't able to go to because he got sick. So he never really left the hotel room. We ended up flying back from Chicago, and that's okay. But when we got back, he was still really sick. And we did tests, and I remember calling our doctor, J.B. Humphrey, he's a member of this church, and saying, J.B., I think it's this, I think it's this, I think it's this, because you know why? Because I Googled it. And J.B. said to me, well, just bring him in. Let me take a look at him. And I go, yeah, but here's what I did. I don't think it's this, and I don't think it's this. And I took a picture. I said, Trevor, I know your mouth is hurting, but open your mouth. Nice and wide. I can't even open it. Do you remember this? Open your mouth. I took a picture. I think I see white spots, so that must be strep throat. So we got to do this, and we got to do this. I'm telling this through text to my doctor, JB. And he goes, yeah, you know, just bring him in. And as I think about that, that was my prideful, probably, way of saying to JB, you know, your guess is as good as mine, but in reality, my guess is not as good as his. I'm a pastor. He's a doctor. So he didn't say this, but I know he was thinking, if I have a question about the Bible, I'll call you. If you have a sick kid, you bring him into me. But we live in a world where the death of expertise and just the humility of saying, you know what, you might know better than me about this is going away. So let me give you one more thing that pushes back against our efforts to be humble, and it's this thing right here. It's echo chambers. I mentioned them earlier. You know what the definition of it? There's an actual sociological definition of echo chambers. Here it is. It's a situation in which beliefs are amplified or reinforced by communication or repetition inside a closed system and insulated from rebuttal, which leads to confirmation bias. Did you take that in? Now, let me just say something it's just gonna kind of push back against us a little bit. All of our social media feeds are doing this, literally by design. They're all run by algorithms meant to increase the echo chamber reality that we live in and just surround us with people who think and talk and believe what we do, and it's a closed system, and it's insulated from rebuttal, and it leads to further and deeper confirmation bias, which makes it harder and harder to live with humility. These are our realities. So humility is very, very important. Let's go to the scriptures for our second building block for unity. It says, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Now that line there in yellow, patience, forbearance, so bearing with one another, bearing with being wronged, and doing it in love, I'm gonna synthesize those three concepts into one word. This is the second building block of unity. Next slide. Sacrifice. Sacrifice. There is no unity among large groups of people. There's no unity in a marriage. There's no unity in a family. There's no unity on a team without sacrifice. And I mentioned earlier how Jesus prayed for unity in John 17. Do you know what Jesus did right after he said amen to that prayer? Here's what happened. He was betrayed by Judas. He was denied by Peter. He was deserted by all of his disciples. He allowed himself to be beaten. He carried his cross to the place on the hill called Calvary, and he allowed himself to be sacrificed for the forgiveness of your sin and my sin. 3 days later, he raised to new life. So Jesus modeled the very thing that we will have to do if we follow him and desire, are willing to work for unity. It requires sacrifice. It might be sacrifice of time. It might be sacrifice of being right or being wronged. It might be a sacrifice. I mean, everybody who loves someone knows that love requires sacrifice. Amen? Okay, so the first building block of unity is humility. The second is sacrifice. Here's the third one. This is how we do it. It's commitment. Commitment. Let me show you where that is in the passage in Ephesians 4. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Look at this next phrase. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Make every effort. That's commitment. Make every effort. willing to work, willing to be committed, that connotes things like grit and determination and tenacity. It's not casual. It's not just hoping. It's not indifference. It's striving. It's steadfast. It's relentless. It's pursuing it. And what is it pursuing? Keeping the unity of the Spirit. It's not just arbitrary unity. It's the unity of the Spirit of God. Now, the Spirit, what's the fruit of the Spirit? Like, what would unity of the Spirit look like? The fruit of the Spirit, love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. Can't have unity without self-control. So it's being willing to say, I'm sorry. It's being willing to initiate reconciliation. It's being willing to quickly forgive and to move on. These are all things that are part of the commitment, a building block of unity. I just think of a marriage. The marriage vows require incredible commitment. Incredible commitment. Grit to have a great marriage. Grit. You need determination. You need tenacity. It doesn't happen on its own. It doesn't just have a great, so here the wedding vows, till death do us part. That takes commitment. For better or for worse, that takes commitment. In sickness and in health, that takes commitment. As I was praying for you this week, I thought, you know, one of the things I love about our church is it's filled with a bunch of, like, there are a bunch of leaders in our church. There's leaders in business. There's leaders of teams. There's leaders of families. There's leaders on coaches, on fields. There's leaders in the church. There's leaders in our schools. Just a lot of leaders. And so a lot of people, I know your heart, you want to be great leaders. And there are books, there are articles written about great leaders. One that I came across this week in the Harvard Business Review by Jim Collins, who wrote the book Good to Great. Here's what he says about what he calls level five, that's the top level leaders. It kind of synthesizes these points. Here's what he says. Level five leaders are people with a mix of profound humility and furious resolve. Profound humility, it's gonna require some sacrifice, but furious resolve, that's grit, that's determination, that's tenacity. I want to be a leader like that. And you probably do as well. How do we get there? What's the big idea? We must be willing to work for unity. It doesn't come naturally. Now, as we close our time, I want to tell a quick story about how much unity can be elusive and how it's a little bit fragile, to be honest. And sometimes in the quest, striving for unity, whether it's in the church, whether it's in our family, in a marriage, on a team, for those of you that are on a team or leaders of a team, sometimes it feels like in the quest for unity, we're taking two steps forward and then we take one step back. And the story happened just a couple of weeks ago. It was when we were in Hawaii. I had a day in Hawaii that was a dream come true. And the day on our family trip was, we got a chance with my three sons and me to play a round of golf for the first time in our lives together. It was something that I had dreamed about. I had built it up in my mind for years. One day we're gonna be old enough where we can all make our way around a golf course and not embarrass ourselves. It's gonna be enjoyable. It's gonna be fun. And it was, here's a picture of us on the first tee in Hawaii. And it was, I'm just gonna tell you, it was glorious. It was like one of my favorite days. It was a true highlight of this trip. This is up on the first tee. And Bridget didn't play. Bridget had some time to herself. She exercised, she relaxed, she read. But I said, Bridget, if you want to join us, babe, if you, like the holes 16, 17, 18, there's 18 holes in a round of golf. Takes about 4 to 4.5 hours usually to play a round of golf. I said, if you want to join us for the last like 30, 40 minutes, that would be cool. Holes 16, 17, 18 are like the prettiest on the course. It's like what the course is known for. They go a little bit toward the water and stuff like that. So join us for those holes. And so for the first, honestly, 15 holes, it was glorious. Our boys were playing well. We were getting along. They were encouraging one another. It wasn't perfect. So we got three boys that are pretty competitive. Anybody relate to that? Just say amen. Let me make me feel better. Say amen louder so I can feel a little bit. Jeez. Don't hold out on me when I'm trying to be vulnerable here. But honestly, it was incredible. It was incredible for about 15 holes. And then here's the truth. Bridget shows up on the 16th hole. She's a great encourager. But I think what happened is the boys got a little tense trying to impress their mom. They may push back about that, but I've been around long enough to know that type of thing happens. And all of a sudden, the balls started flying all over the place. and it got a little more tense. And so 16th hole didn't go well. Nobody played that hole well. And we're just like, people are getting a little frustrated. So then we took this picture on the 17th tee. It's kind of the prettiest hole on the course. Took this picture, Bridget took it, and we were still kind of holding it together. We were leaking oil a little bit, but we were holding it together. And then Bridget goes off the side, and we tee off on 17, and the balls are going all over the place, and one, I'm not going to name any names because it'd be too convicting, but one of my sons swings, and he shanks a ball, and he turns around, he says something to Bridget, he goes, man, that wasn't hit him like that before you got here. And she goes, oh my gosh. And that was kind of a mean thing to say. And then another one of our boys sent one into the lava. And then when he got out of the cart, he could have easily walked around his brother. I mean, it was easier, literally, to walk around his brother, but he didn't. He was frustrated. So he got in front of him, gave him a little, you know, they give him a little chest bump as they're passing him. So he didn't like that. So one of them took his glasses, and the glasses are black, took his sunglasses and threw him out into the lava about 20 feet in the lava. So I'm like, oh my gosh, are we going to be able to find him? And so we were unraveling. The unity was gone. It was there for 3 hours and 40 minutes, and then we lost it. And then Bridget looked at me and she goes, if this is how it's, I was like, no, this, I promise you, this was not how it has been. I was texting, I'm like, it was great for a long time. Trust me, it's just not great right now. She goes, I don't think I can handle this. I think I'm gonna go. And so she leaves for the last hole. And so I'm going, okay. And then we play it on 18. And not all of us have a good hole on 18, so one of the boys starts to slink off after he holes out on 18. I go, whoa, this is not how you end a round of golf. Said, you wait for everybody to putt out, then you take off your hat, and you shake each other's hand or you give each other a hug, and then we go off. Like, that's how you finish a round of golf for the rest of your life. And then we went back, and I realized now I had some, like, repair work to do, and I thought, I was thinking about unity. I'm like, it is so easy to go two steps forward and then one step back. Like, it requires work. It requires humility. I went to Bridget. I go, listen, I know that wasn't what you wanted. And she's going like, gosh, is it just, you know, are they better off without me? Like, no, it's not that. It's not that. Let's go for a walk. And I go back to the boys after giving them a little time to separate, you know, 5 hours, pretty close. But just humility and sacrifice of time and of plans. It requires those types of things. Humility and sacrifice and commitment, gosh. So you know this in your own life. And you want we want unity in the church. We want unity in our marriages and our families and our friendships. We want it on our teams. The question is, are we willing to work for it? So let's stand and pray. We'll be on our way. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this service, a chance to celebrate the movement of your Holy Spirit through music and sacrament, baptisms, through life transformation stories. Thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you for the blessings of unity. Behold, you gotta see this, how good and pleasant it is when God's people, brothers and sisters, live together in unity. It's like precious oil poured down on the head and then dripping down onto the beard, not just the beard, but Aaron's beard, and then onto his robe. It's like the dew of Mount Hermon falling down on Mount Zion. For there, every place unity is experienced and worked for there it's a place of blessing. There it's anointed by God. There it's enjoyable, it's good, and it's pleasant. There it's a little taste of heaven. Thank you, Lord. Yet, Holy Spirit, now is a time where we've heard the truth of your word, and it behooves us to pause and to ask you, God, can you search our hearts and show us any ways that we may not be contributing to unity in our church or in our marriages or toward our spouse or maybe toward our siblings or our parents or our kids or to other members of a team? Could be at school, could be in a sport, could be at work. And God, we open our hearts up and ask and give permission for your Holy Spirit to bring conviction. Maybe we need to repent. Maybe we need to seek reconciliation. Maybe we need to offer forgiveness. Maybe we need to be humble. Maybe we need to sacrifice. Maybe we need to renew our commitment. So Father, thank you. Thank you for your word. Jesus, thank you for the sacrifice so that if and when we do repent, if and when we do feel the sting of conviction, that we know that your response is grace upon grace. That you have shown us the way to experience unmerited, undeserved favor for the things that we're not proud of, that we feel like we've done wrong, that we want to get right. And you give us the grace and the power to change, to heal, to be transformed. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for your word. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Have a great week, and we'll see you next week as we wrap up this great series.